Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Modern Green Bay and Western in N-Scale. My name is Gabe. We're back over here on the New London side of the layout at Embarrass Creek. We got a CSX SD70 ACE pulling a bridge freight through the area. Today, we're going to start working on the Highway 45 overpass over the Green Bay and Western Main Line here in New London. This will be a multi-part video, I know for a fact. Today we're just going to focus on building scenery forms, not just necessarily here at the bridge site, but also in a couple other locations on the layout that we're going to work on at the same time. So, thanks for watching so far, and let's get into the project, and I'll show you where and what we plan on doing in this area. Thanks. So we're gonna start here in New London. That was the Embarrass Bridge and the Embarrass Creek that we just passed by. And then as we go east here, we have three tracks here. We have the spur to Granite Valley Forest Products. This is the Green Bay and Western Main Line, and this switch and track that will be laid eventually is the sneak off to the Fox Valley and Lake Superior Railroad. So US 45 crosses the Green Bay and Western. Now the Fox Valley and Lake Superior, or Fox Valley and Lake Superior in reality, in the modern day, crosses three times. Once as US 45, there's another, which is a bridge. There's also another bridge in New London that's not going to be modeled, which is an off-ramp from US 45. And then also Business 45, which crosses at surface level, which is this road here. So US 45 here is a two-lane bridge that goes across. What we're going to do is kind of model it more after the off-ramp. And for a couple reasons, it's more visually interesting. You can see that here in these pictures I got from Google Maps. You can see this one is what the US 45 crossing looks like. There's no piers or anything, and nothing super interesting there. And then this is what the US 45 off-ramp looks like. I kind of like that it's got the piers, the extra supports. Then also kind of I noticed that both of these kind of look like, kind of got like a wedding cake, almost not realistic. And because they are built up, this isn't a natural landform that the railroad is built through. So we're just going to model just the US 45 bridge. And I'll show you why. I just think having also another bridge here that crosses in this area will just clutter this up too much. And in reality, the bridge really only crosses the main line. But, you know, there's only so much we can do when we're modeling and doing kind of selective compression. So let's take a look at the bridge kit I'm going to be using. For the overpass, we're going to be using this Rick's Products Modern 150-foot highway overpass. It should be long enough for us to do our entire length from the edge of the layout to the backdrop. We're not going to be building it today, but what we do need to do is open it up and get an idea how tall this thing is, so we know how tall we need to make our hills for it to rest on. Just gonna pull this out. Kind of shows you the parts we got going here. I think this is a fairly realistic looking bridge. I think it's gonna help out a lot because these kind of look like the piers on the real one. However, I don't think it needs to be quite that tall. It just needs to be tall enough for me to fit and locomotives, double stack, intermodal cars and stuff over. So first we need to find out how tall this thing is gonna be. In doing some reading here, it appears I can just adjust the height of these and the foundation as much as or a little as I need to get the height I want. So in looking at this picture, this looks comically high, so it will be a little bit lower. I want to put the height at 2 inches, and doing some measuring, that way the deck will be at 2 inches. I think that should work and give us enough room for the trains to go under. also is going to make my life a lot easier when it comes to putting down the foam, because we're using 1-inch slabs of foam. So this is where I decided to put the bridge, and looking at the directions, it doesn't matter where these joints are, the piers can go anywhere under the bridge, so that's what we're going to do. It's also give me a little extra room over here to make it end into the wall here, and honestly I don't even know if I'm going to need all three plates once I get the scenery form built. It'll kind of help inform how long the bridge is going to be. But first we're going to mark the rough location of the bridge here. Kind of got an idea. So it doesn't have to be picture perfect, because this is all going to get adjusted as I build scenery and stuff. So, that done. Move these off to the side, make it look a little better, but alright. Now on to scenery forms. So this is what we're using, 1-inch foam, just like what we got down here. We're gonna cut it out so that it kind of resembles what we're looking for. To do that, get yourself a piece of newspaper, or in this case, I am using some directions for one of my lights that I have laying around. And we're gonna put it on here as best as we can. We're going to draw some forms. I think we're going to start with this side along the track. This is supposed to be a somewhat unrealistic looking shape, because it is, in fact, man-made. So I'm just going to put where the track is, so we know it can't go there. And then I'm also going to mark here where I got the road, where the bridge is going to be coming off. And then I'm going to do the same thing over here. What I just need it to be is not overlapping, because we're going to cut this out, so this in-between part really doesn't matter. But what I do need to do is kind of mark where the backdrop will be. So there's the backdrop portion, and here's where the track will be. Alright. Okay, the paper patterns have been cut out, and in looking at maps of the area, the hill they built up to make the overpass go across is really just big enough for the road. So what we are going to do here is kind of draw that in here, and we're going to cut that out too. We also don't want this going straight up to the tracks, so because there's got to be room for drainage and whatnot. I'm going to go like that. And this piece is going to be the lower piece, so we want it to be bigger. I think what we'll do is make this sign just a tad larger. Yeah. That should work on that side. And then same idea for over here. And like so. So now that those are adjusted, let's cut out those paper patterns, and we'll go start cutting some foam. So here's the form. This is the side that is actually on the aisle side. I'm actually gonna flip my form upside down, because this is the extent I want it to be, and I'm going to cut so that it's angled this way, so that this is the farthest extent of the bottom of the building. Cut it out, I'm just using this Sawzall, and I'm gonna cut this at an angle like so. And that is the first form. Let's go see if that works out in the layout. So here we go, there's that first form. I go worry about there. Honestly, looks pretty good to me. We're just gonna have to do one more layer. It's gonna be cut back a lot more to kind of give it that layered look that you saw in the Google Maps picture. Let's go do that next. For this next piece, I want to use the same concept as I did before. We're going to use the top portion here. Get some of that off so that we can better lay it down. And that is going to be what we'll use the next portion here. So I am going to mark that on here. There we go. Same concept, this I want to be the bottom, and I'm actually probably going to cut in. I'm actually going to draw it here because I want it to be noticeable. Probably going to be like so. That's where we're, how we're going to make the cuts. So let's do that. Yeah, that looks pretty good. Let's go fit it on the layout. Okay, there's the two pieces together. Actually looks pretty decent. This is not the finished product. However, it gives us the basic forms that we need. So I'm gonna carry on with doing this to the other side of the track. And same process, same idea, just different shape. So yeah, we don't need to see that. Here's how the scenery forms look. All four have been cut out. Kind of got that little bit of a wedding cake look that you could see in the Google Maps photos. The next step would be to glue both of these down so that we can better form them and make them look more realistic and more natural, even though these aren't natural. However, that's going to prove a problem over here with this backdrop in the way. So this side will get glued down before we start shaping and stuff. This side, however, I may just glue together the top and the bottom, work on shaping it off of the layout, and then glue it in. And that's not actually a bad idea for this side, too. So, but we do need to get them glued together first so that we can shape them, make them look more realistic together.
All
right, let's do that. We're over here at the workbench, and it's time to glue these together. So, what we're going to use is this Loctite Power Grab Heavy Duty. Normally I use liquid nails for project, but I found this and it seemed to be what I was looking for. Whatever you use to put your foam together, make sure that it's able to be used on foam board. Because if you don't, I believe it's super glue. If you put a drop on here, it'll just start burning through the foam. So you want to make sure whatever you have will actually work on foam and not burn through it. Cause some sort of crazy catastrophic chemical reaction that you don't want. But yeah, this appears to be what I need. Like I said, I normally use liquid nails for projects, but whatever you end up using, just make sure that it works for foam board. Well, this tube is an excessive amount that I don't really need for this little project. It will be helpful on other projects in the future, because I have other places I want to put some scenery forms and whatnot, and hills, and this will be quite helpful. And best practice normally is to kind of push this stuff down, move it around a bit, kind of spread it out. Oof. I'm trying to line up the back here. Got a little overflow there. Fix that up. And the next piece does not need nearly as much. Same deal here. Try to get it to line up. Probably gonna move it over a little bit. This side concerns me a little bit because of how small my area for my road is gonna be, but I think we'll make it work, especially once we start building an abutment and whatnot. So, okay. There's that, and now we just gotta let this stuff glue. So now it's the next day. It's time to finalize the shape and start shaping our foam that we have cut out and built up. So to do that, I use a couple different tools. Sawzall, a little handheld one, any sort of small saw like this to help cut out big chunks. A nice little X-Acto knife for small chunks. Some sanding blocks. These are medium grits. They should work well. A wire brush I've never used before, but I've been told it works good. and then a file. That's also a good thing to have. So that's what we're going to be used to shape in the foam blocks. Time to do the final step, which is gluing our foam hills onto the layout. One more step might be if you're trying to blend it into existing scenery. Here I'm just trying to blend into flat ground, so it's not such a big deal. You may want to glue it on before you start shaping stuff, because that will make it a little easier to make it look natural and blend it in with your scenery. However, I'm kind of going to flat ground. I thought this would be kind of in the way. So put it on there. Make sure you kind of move it around a bit. Try to get it right where she needs to go. So there's that piece. Now I can hear some of you wondering why I use the heavy duty glue. It's because you're doing all that shaping work on it. For scenery purposes and stuff that isn't going to move. Eileen's tacky glue would work good enough, but it's not going to allow you to wrench on it and reef on it like I just did to shape it up. So that, this portion of this bridge project is pretty much complete. So here's the finished product so far. We got the two hills on either side of the tracks, and we got GB&W 210 pulling a train westward through town. I like to appreciate everybody who's watching. Please like and subscribe. This is my two cents on how to build foam hills for your layout. This can be applied to even bigger hills and mountains and stuff like that. So again, I appreciate everybody watching, and we'll continue this project at a later date. I probably won't be the next video, but this project will be ongoing. So again, thanks for watching, and have a great rest of your day. Bye.